Good morning, Cross Pointe. It is so great to see you. Psalm 113, verse 3 states, from the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. So we ask that you join your voices with ours as we praise our God in this room and you at home as well. Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it arise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. Let it arise. Let praise arise. Come on, let's sing it. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry. The song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise. Let faith arise. Let it arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh,
this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. Come on, let's sing.
This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise.
We'll see you break down every wall.
We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry. The giants fall, for fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh,
say we praise you.
For worshiping with us. At this time, you may be seated. We just simply ask that you turn your attention to the baptismal.
Introducing to you Jeremy. This is Jeremy right here. This is the first time that I've ever seen him without his glasses. So I just whispered to him. I said, it's like I'm baptizing just a new person. So Jeremy has been going to our church for about 8 or 9-ish months. He came in August or September of last year. And Jeremy was saved in college. And I skipped to that really quick because what I wanted to highlight most from Jeremy's testimony is something that he said in the after salvation part. You know, Doc said from the pulpit last week, and we laugh on staff because he says a lot, he says, if your religion hasn't changed your life, then you ought to change your religion. And we all laugh, but really what we're looking at is when you spend time in God's word, especially when you meet Jesus, your life really should change. And we ask a question in every testimony form that says, how has your life changed since you've met Jesus? And Jeremy wrote a whole lot, but the first line said, when asked how has he changed, he said, so many ways that I can't even believe. And that's really, church, what we want to see in those who follow Jesus. We want to see true life change. So Jeremy today has come to make a public profession of his faith. Jeremy, Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. What is your profession of faith?
Jesus is my Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen. Jeremy, based on your profession of faith, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Church, I can't think of a better way for us to start our services this morning. Jeremy is a great friend, and so we're so excited to see him baptized today. If this is your first time at Crosspoint, I just want to thank you for worshiping with us. We would love for you to register your visit. You can do that at crosspointchurch.com/first, or you can scan the QR code on the seat back in front of you. But we would love to know that you are here and be able to serve you better. If you fill that out, we have a gift for you at the welcome desk that you can pick up on your way out. This is a really special Sunday. It's special for a number of reasons. We've got the Lord's Supper today, we have baptism, but we're also highlighting our next gen today because all of this week we are going to be sending out over 100 of our kids, students, and next gen volunteers to go to summer camp. And it's gonna be an exhausting week, but it's gonna be a really fun and meaningful time as well. And so throughout the service, you're gonna see different next gen faces highlighted, like Mia right here. So let me tell you about Mia. She has become a very dear friend to me. She actually grew up in this church. Her grandmother leads a small group on Wednesdays, and her mom volunteers with me over in the kids area caring for special needs kids. And Mia, I have been able to see you grow up here over the past few years that I've been here, and you have just become a really strong leader in our Next Gen ministry. So Mia, why are you excited for camp?
Church, I'm so excited for camp, not just because I get to hang out with my friends, make a lot of memories, and have a lot of good, friendly competition, but because I get to go closer with my faith, and I get to learn more about God. Something about camp really ties me in, and every year I go, it just gets better and better, so I'm really excited.
Awesome, Mia. We were talking right before the service, and she said she goes to every single camp that she possibly can, and we're so glad that you do. As we continue in worship, I just want to read for us Ephesians 5, starting at the end of verse 18. It says, "Be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, and giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." This is a Sunday where we celebrate, we praise together, and we just look forward to what God is doing. And so I just ask all of you to stand, greet somebody next to you, and then we are going to continue in worship. Good news of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's lift this up.
In the darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to praise the Father, praise the Son.
For our worship team. You guys can go ahead and take a seat. I don't know if you know this or not, but that song was primarily led by one of our seventh grade going into eighth grade students, Ava Alford. How incredible is that? We've really tried to be intentional this Sunday to highlight and show you guys how thankful we are for a number of our students that in next generation kids and students that we have here in this church. So you heard from Mia, Ava led you guys in this song. I'm going to introduce Landon here in just a second, but we have so much to be grateful for here in our church, but we don't just have things to be grateful for here in our church. We have things to be grateful for in this nation. As many of you know, this weekend we pause and we reflect and we remember Memorial Day. And so we look back on the sacrifices of those that many have made before us, and we pause and remember that the freedom we have to meet in a building like this, in a country like this, is because of the sacrifice that was made by so many who have gone before us. And so as we as a church pause and we reflect on all of the things that we have to be grateful for, one of the things that we want to be express our gratitude to you guys for is your generosity and your giving. We've got a couple different ways that you can give. It'll be on the screens. You can give here in person or you can give online. But what I want you to know is that when you give to this church, you are giving for Ava's, you are giving for Mia's, you are giving for the development of students just like Landon, who are growing up in this church. They're learning about God's word, they're learning about the good news of the gospel, and then they are being equipped and sent out into the rest of the world. So we want to thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness in that. So I've got Landon here with me. A couple of you may have noticed we've got these cards in your seat. These cards have a couple of different ways that you can pray for us as we go to summer camp. And on the back of it, it actually has the name of every student, every kid, every leader that is going with us to camp. So Landon is one of our rising seniors. He is a staple in our student ministry. And so we thought what a really cool opportunity it would be this morning for Landon as we prepare to go to camp tomorrow morning, for Landon to pray over us in our service. And so Landon, would you take a moment and just do that for us now?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come here today and learn more about your word. I just pray that you softened all of our students' hearts and that you allow your glory to be shown. I pray that even though we're having fun and competing, that we understand the true purpose of camp is to grow closer to you and grow closer to each other, and that ultimately camp will glorify you. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. It has been a great Sunday already, and it is going to be a great week here in the life of our church. So glad that you made the decision to wake up this morning and to come and worship with us. And as always, before I begin, I want to pause just a moment and thank Dr. Merritt for the opportunity to stand up here before you and to open up God's Word this morning. I don't take that lightly, and super grateful that Doc continues to pour in to the young guys on staff. And I want to echo what Ryan and Landon mentioned just a moment ago. I want you to take seriously the challenge to take that card home with you today and to pray through those prayer prompts this week. We know many of you, just because of schedules and works and so forth, can't join us this week for camp. You can't be there in person. But we believe you can be there with us in spirit, and that you can lift our students up and lift our leaders up, and it will be a great week of camp this week. And so, now obviously, as you just saw a moment ago, today is a very special Sunday. It's the Sunday where we get to celebrate the Lord's Supper. And so if you didn't get a chance to get one of the elements on the way in, if you'll go ahead and go to one of those back tables and grab one of those at this time, that would be a huge help. I grew up in church my whole life. I watched my mom and my dad take the Lord's Supper. And I can remember being a very little kid at age 4 or age 5, and I was so confused by it. I couldn't really understand what it was all about. You know, growing up in my house, when we had supper, we called it supper, not dinner. And so when I would go to church and they would say, hey, we're going to take the Lord's Supper today, it did not register in my mind. So I would go to my mom and my dad and I would say, hey, if the church is calling this a supper, can we not at least get a little bit bigger piece of bread? I mean, can we not make this a little bit worthwhile here? And then I got saved a couple of years later, and I remember I was so excited the first time I got to actually partake in the Lord's Supper, and it was around the same time that, you know, you kind of go from being a little kid, you don't really dress too nice, and then your parents start dressing you a little bit nicer going to church. And I will never forget the moment that my mom and dad bought me a nice new, I mean brand new pair of khaki pants to wear on Sunday morning. And to give an 8 or 9 year old a cup of grape juice filled to the absolute brim is utterly terrifying. That is, that you want to talk about pressure at age 9 or age 10, that is what you would call pressure. But even as I got older, more questions came to my mind about this. And so what I want to do is answer my own questions as we examine the Lord's Supper this morning. Theologian N.T. Wright famously said, when Jesus wanted to explain to his disciples what his death was all about, he didn't give them a theory. He gave them a meal. And this meal takes place in Luke chapter 22. If you have a Bible with you, if you'll take it and turn there this morning. Luke is one of the four Gospels. It's the third book in the New Testament. And so Luke is writing to essentially chronicle the life of Jesus from an eyewitness perspective. And up to this point in his book, he has detailed the different teachings, miracles, and events in the life of Jesus. And so by the time we get to our passage today in Luke chapter 22, there is this ongoing building plot to kill Jesus initiated by angry religious leaders. And so this plot has now thickened, and Jesus knows that his time on earth is about to come to an end. And so Jesus then gathers his disciples for what we know as the Lord's Supper. So for just a couple of moments this morning, I want to pause and answer this question about the Lord's Supper. What does examining this supper challenge us to do? As a result of us reading it and studying it, what should we do? Luke chapter 22, we'll pick it up in verse 14. The Bible says this, "And when the hour came, he reclined at the table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And verse 19, and he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup is poured out for you, is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of him who betrays me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to question one another, saying which of them it could be who was going to do this. So this morning, church, what does examining the supper challenge us to do? A couple quick things. Number one, we should desire unity with Christ. We should desire unity with Christ. This happens in verses 14 and really in verse 15 when Jesus says there, he says, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you. Now, in the English, it doesn't look like much. It's something we would say to one another. I'm starving. Let's go eat. I want to share this with you. But if you look more specifically in the original language, it's the literal reading of it is this. It's with desire, I did desire to eat this Passover. In other words, it is a desire on top of another desire. He's using this to magnify the intensity of that word to show them how much he wanted to eat this with them. So if you do a quick word search of that word desire in Scripture, it pops up in a few other places. Twice in Luke, who's describing the prodigal son, first of which, he longed to eat the slop that the pigs ate. And then again describing the prodigal son, he uses that word desire showing that he longed to eat the crumbs from the rich man's table. And then Peter, a little while later in the New Testament, uses it to describe the things which angels long to look. But in all three of those references, desire is only mentioned one time. But here, specifically, Jesus uses desire two times strategically to show them how much he wanted to eat this meal with them. And consequently, because we are supposed to continue this tradition over and over again, reminding ourselves of what Christ has done, he also has the same desire and feeling towards you and me today. It is astounding in my mind to comprehend that the God of all galaxies wants to spend time with you and me. The God who created everything desires to have an intimate relationship with you. He desires to commune with you at his table. But it also expresses a strong desire for intimate remembrance and fellowship among believers. In other words, Jesus is modeling for us what he wants us to do. He wants each of us in the room and watching online right now to have moments in time where we slow our minds, we calm our hearts, and we remember what Jesus has done for us. It was Jesus that paid the ultimate sacrifice. You see, Jesus developed these relationships because they created an avenue, a lane for him to then go and pass on his truth and his mission to his disciples. So the Lord's Supper, it serves a couple different purposes. First and foremost, the obvious one is yes, it is there for us to pause and reflect and remember what Jesus has done for us. But it also shouldn't leave us there, but it should actually then springboard us and motivate us to action to live as ambassadors for Jesus. If you think about it and put it in proper perspective, these were some of Jesus' last words before he died. And he chose to gather his disciples around a table and to share with them about his upcoming death. In other words, Jesus takes this time to model to his disciples what he wanted them to do, what he wanted them to carry out. In my mind, I like word pictures. This reminds me of a relay race in track. Anybody ever run track in here? In high school, anybody ever run one? Nobody likes running. Okay, great. That's what I thought. Anybody know what this is called? A baton, very good. I ran one event in high school and they never asked me to run again, so I'll let you read between those lines. 4x1, 4x2, 4x400, they have one of these things and the first runner passes it to the second runner and the second one passes it to the third and the third passes it to the fourth. We're getting warmed up. I promise you we're getting there. In my mind, there's my little CrossPoint logo, you like that? This is exactly what Jesus was doing. As he sits them at this table, he's saying, boys, my time is about to come to an end. I'm gonna give my life for the sake of the world, and I'm gonna give this to you. I'm gonna give you this message to go and share with the rest of the world. Don't forget what I'm about to do for you. I like this word picture so much. We've started something here with our student ministry that we call Anchor Weekend. And Anchor Weekend is only for our eighth graders that are about to go into their freshman year of high school. and we take them away for the weekend, and we preach through Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2, which says this: "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." And it's during this weekend with those eighth graders about to embark on their last 4 years of grade school, we give them one of these batons and we say, the gospel message is yours to behold. You are a herald. You are a messenger. You are a keeper of the gospel. Now go live it out. Make the most of your high school years. Make the most of your college years. And you find people in your life to pass the baton to. So let me pause right there for just a moment. I think we remember what Jesus has done, but then we should also have people in our life that we have the baton in our hand and we are desperately trying to give that baton to them. We are desperately trying to show them the way and say, here is what Jesus commands us to do. Some of the final words of Jesus were simply, I deeply and fervently desire to spend this time with you. It's my hope and my prayer this morning that you have a desire to also spend time with Jesus. Then we see a second thing this morning. We are to anticipate the return of Christ. We are to anticipate the return of Christ. This is in verse 16, really. It says, "For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Now, this goes all the way back to the Old Testament, in which the nation of Israel also celebrated a meal that we know as Passover. And Passover simply remembers the moment in time back in the book of Exodus when God delivered his people out of captivity in the land of Egypt. And so the Passover meal looked back at Israel's deliverance and God's intervention. And the Lord's Supper does two things. It also looks back, but it also looks forward to the day in which Jesus will come again. That's why Jesus says, until it is fulfilled in the kingdom. Jesus here is also taking this time to point his disciples to a future day in which all people are gathered to him for eternity. This idea of Christ coming back is a big deal in the Bible. In fact, over 1/4 of the Bible is what we know as predictive prophecy, most of which refers to the fact that Jesus has not left us alone, that Jesus is coming back one day. And every time you see little hints or little glimpses that Jesus will return to this earth one day, it is always associated with this idea of hope. If you look at the Bible from cover to cover in Genesis to Revelation, one of the main themes that you will see is hope. That of anybody that's walking on planet Earth right now, a follower of the Lord Jesus has more hope than everyone else combined because Jesus is coming back. That's why I think there's so many references of Jesus coming back in Scripture. It's to instill that hope within us. That's why our current life circumstances shouldn't predicate our hope, right? So even if you're sick, you can have hope. Even if you're lonely, you can have hope. Even if you're stressed, you can have hope. Even if you're tired, you can have hope. No matter what is going through or how hard life gets, we can have hope in this world filled with chaos and confusion because Jesus promises to return. Jesus promises to come back and get us. That's why A.W. Tozer said these words. He said, "Let us be alert to the season in which we are living. It's the season of the blessed hope, calling for us to cut our ties with the world and build ourselves on this one who will soon appear. He is our hope, a blessed hope, enabling us to rise above our times and fix our gaze upon him." To anticipate the return of Christ is to fix your gaze upon Christ. And to fix your gaze upon Christ is to anticipate his return. These two things go hand in hand. That's why Jesus says in verse 17, he says, when he had given thanks, he had offered this thanks for this meal. And if you do a quick study on that word, given thanks, it's actually a very special word. It's two Greek words that we now get the word Eucharist from. It means good and it means grace. And so when you slap those two words together, you get good grace. So what is Jesus trying to tell us this morning? That Jesus, when he gave thanks for this meal, he's acknowledging to God the Father how good his grace truly is. And similarly, in just a couple of moments, when we take the Lord's Supper, we too are recognizing the goodness of God's grace in our life. We can't long for the future and long for Jesus to return until we recognize what he's done for us in the past. These two go hand in hand. And that's why Jesus said, maybe most importantly, in verse 18, he says, from now on. Right? It's not a moment of sadness. It's a moment of extreme optimism. Right? Jesus is not saying, okay, fellas, this is the end. After tonight, I'm never going to see you boys ever again. What he is saying is that, hey, even though our earthly time is coming to an end, it's going to be gloriously renewed in the kingdom that will be for all people. In other words, Jesus is saying, hey, fellas, I want you to listen in here. I'm about to take care of your past. I'm going to guide you in the present, and I'm going to give you hope for the future. Buckle your seatbelt, hang on tight. I have not left you for dead. I will be with you. That's why we, all of us in the room and watching online right now, we should long for eternity. We should long to be unified with him. Why? Because that's where our hope is. That's why we can all come together on Sunday morning and say, come, Lord Jesus, come. We anticipate his return. But then finally this morning, we remember the work of Christ. The number one thing and the number one reason we celebrate the Lord's Supper is we remember what Jesus has done for us. In verses 19 and 20, he simply offers the meal and they eat the meal together. And in that those two verses, we see that the bread here represents the body of Christ that looks forward in that moment to the time just a couple hours later when Jesus would lay down his life. He would give his life for you and me. So this body speaks of his death for his people. And if you know your Bible, Jesus actually is reflecting on a moment from earlier in which he taught his disciples a similar lesson. If you go back to John chapter 6, one of the most fascinating chapters in all of Scripture, Jesus teaches them about this bread earlier. In chapter 6, verse 33, he says this, "For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." So if you and I were the disciples and we were sitting there listening to this, we'd say, yeah, that sounds pretty good. The disciples hear this, they respond, "Sir, give us this bread always." And then the very next verse, Jesus responds and says to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." And then a few moments later in verse 51, he says, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." And Jesus is telling the disciples then, and he's telling the disciples now, he's reminding them, "I am going to give my life for you." He's using this analogy and this metaphor to describe a literal truth that is about to happen before their very eyes. And in my opinion, the Apostle Peter summarizes what happens here and explains the gravity of what's happened in 1 Peter 2, verse 24. He said this, speaking of Jesus, he said, "He himself, he bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed." You see, Jesus died so that we could then die to our sin and be declared righteous. Not because of your church attendance or your serving record, or anything like that that's works-based, but simply because Jesus has died in your place. It is his wounds that set us free. But then you also have the cup. And the cup represents the blood of Jesus that was poured out on the cross. It was the ultimate sacrifices of all sacrifices done once for the payment of our sins. As a result of Jesus laying down his own life, there is no need for us to go and make continual sacrifices on our behalf. Jesus took care of it, and he took care of it once for all. And maybe the best part about this morning and what I love about Scripture is small little nuances and small little words. Go to verse 19 with me. Notice who it's for, which is given for you. That word for is tiny, but has a massive, massive deal of meaning. The word for usually means on behalf of, in place of, or for the sake of. And I think of all different instances in which you see this in Scripture, it's very present in Paul's writing, specifically in Galatians. So if you'll look with me on the screen, Galatians 1:4 says this, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age according to the will of God and Father. In other words, Paul is saying on behalf of Jesus that it was Jesus's sinless body is sacrificed in place of our sinful body on the cross. Then if you go to the very next chapter, Galatians 2:20, he says this, I have been crucified with Christ. It's me up there. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me, and here it is, gave himself for me. See, when we take the Lord's Supper, we are remembering what Jesus has done for us on the cross. So those three statements, on behalf of, in place of, for the sake of, they're gonna be on the screen with a blank. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna read the first part of that, and when we get to the blank, I want you to insert your name. Say it out loud. It might be weird. It might be awkward. I'm a middle school pastor. We're gonna go right through the awkwardness, okay? Insert your name where the blank is, because I want it to stick in your mind for what Jesus has done. Here's the first one. Loud and proud. Jesus gave himself for the sake of. Jesus gave himself on behalf of. Jesus gave himself instead of. See, in taking the Lord's Supper, we remember what Christ has done for us. And as we get to the supper itself, it challenges you and it challenges me to examine our own heart. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 11:27, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. The Bible is very clear, it doesn't mince its words, that the Lord's Supper is reserved for those that have a relationship with Jesus. There's been a point in time in your life where you have repented of your sin and you have trusted in Christ. So as kindly and as politely as I know how, I'm gonna ask you that if you're in the room with us and you don't have a relationship with Jesus and you've never repented of your sins and confessed that Jesus Christ is Lord, that you would refrain from taking the supper with us. And in a few moments, I'm gonna come back and address that specific audience in just a moment. But I want to make sure that we have a proper reverence and understanding and humility of what the Lord's Supper is. And for the believers in the room, we are called, we are almost ordained to take it with a clean heart, with a right spirit. Which means we must come before the Lord, ask him to remove our sin, to prepare our hearts so we can adequately remember what Jesus has done for us. So here's what we're gonna do. Over the next few moments, I'm gonna pray. And I'm gonna ask that you pray silently right there in your seat, that I'm gonna ask that God would call sin to mind, that you would repent of your sin, And then as I pray, I want you to pray that you would get right with God so that we as a body of Christ here this morning, that we would be able to take the Lord's Supper in a holy and in a righteous manner. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you have made. And God, we will rejoice and we will be glad in it. God, I'm grateful for this church. I'm grateful for this time that we get to slow our minds, to calm our hearts, stop our busy lives, and fix our gaze upon you. And God, I pray for every single person in this room right now. Would you call sin to mind? Would you allow us to repent? Lord, we turn away from our sin. We turn toward you and your goodness and your grace, your forgiveness, and your mercy. God, as we take this supper in just a moment, help us to comprehend exactly what you've done for us. Don't let it just be something else that's rote we do. Lord, but it's a moment in time where we are beyond grateful for your sacrifice. Lord Jesus, we thank you for laying down your life. It should have been me. It was my sin that put you there. It was my sin that had you scourged. It was my sin that had you beaten. It was my sin that had you tortured. But the Rock of Ages, you love me enough. You took on flesh. You went to the cross. And you rose again. And it's for that reason we don't mourn the Lord's Supper. We don't mourn your death. But God, we celebrate it. And we thank you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So if you'll go ahead and grab the elements. The bread they ate that night and the bread in your hand is a representation of the body of Jesus that was given for you and for me on the cross so that we could be in a right relationship with a holy God. As both Peter and Isaiah have said in Scripture, it is by his wounds we are healed. 1 Corinthians 11:24 says, and Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And the cup they held that night, and the cup you hold in your hand is a representation of the blood of Jesus that was shed for you and shed for me on the cross. The Bible teaches us it's the blood of Jesus that covers all our sin. In verses 25 and 26, he says, in the same way, he also took the cup after the supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Jesus then finishes in verse 26. And he said, for as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. May this be an encouragement for us to follow the Lord and proclaim his name to the ends of the earth. But before we close, this picture going back to Luke chapter 22 is not complete without reading the last couple verses. If you look at verses 21 to 23 again, it simply says that the hand of him who betrays me is with me on the table. Fast forwarding to the present day, we now know this was Judas. For some reason, somehow, some way, he was there. He was at the supper. Judas had everyone faked out. He had his family faked out. He had his friends faked out. He had his coworkers faked out. But one. Jesus knew. He had everyone fooled except for Jesus. And I would be remiss. I would do this text a disservice if I would not point out the fact that in a room this size, there could be someone. You look the part. You act the part. You can do church pretty well. You can talk the lingo, yet your heart is far from God. Maybe you've been sitting around and you actually did what I said and you didn't partake in the Lord's Supper. And that left you with a feeling of like you were on the outside looking in. In some ways, I want to encourage you and say that's a good thing. Here's why, because I believe in the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, that is Him and His goodness and in His favor towards you. That is the Lord Jesus reaching down, grabbing a hold of your heart and saying, come to me. I promise to save you. I promise to keep you. I promise that you will never, ever be alone. Or maybe you said, I'm just going to go ahead and partake of the Lord's Supper because I'm going to save myself of the embarrassment of knowing that people knowing I'm not a believer, I'm not a follower of Jesus. So maybe you just did it so you wouldn't stand out. And if that's you, the same invitation is present. Because at the end of this service, we're going to sing a couple more songs here in just a moment. I want you to go out to our Next Steps table, make a bold decision, go right out those back doors and talk with somebody on our Next Steps team. Just say, hey, here's a situation. They'll be able to explain to you what it means to have a relationship with Jesus or to help take your next step. We say this every single week. Austin said it when he baptized a few moments ago in Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's the good news of the gospel message. Maybe you're like, I don't really want to talk to somebody. I don't want to do that. Maybe you're watching online and you physically can't do that. If you would simply go to crosspointchurch.com/next. Put in the name, phone number, email, check the appropriate box. We'd love to follow up with you this week, chat with you over the phone, and just see how we can help serve you and understand better what Jesus has done for you. So this morning, we simply commemorate the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus because Jesus has paid it all. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to go ahead and stand to your feet. We have two more songs. So for those of you that have to get to different areas, I want you to stand to your feet and to sing. Based upon what we have just read and what we have just heard, we commemorate the death of Jesus. We don't mourn and we celebrate that Jesus has risen, that Jesus is alive. So let's finish this Memorial Day Sunday by singing praises to the one who has paid it all for us. Amen. Let's sing together.
of God. Oh, what my heart experienced, when my shame hit the wayside, and my sin met the Most High. I was washed from the inside. I was washed from the inside. How we sing, hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. It was only by the blood of Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. We need you more. We need you, Jesus. It's never been about performance, perfection, or striving for acceptance. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. It's never been about deserving or earning. It's a gift that's freely given. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood.
Expectancy this morning.
When You're strong and I've witnessed it. Tell him today, come on church. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. Yes, I have. You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You're good and I've witnessed it. You're strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it.
To student camp this week. The kids are also going, and I have with me up here, I know you have your prayer guide with you, and we want to really stress that you pray this week. I have the Wheatley family up here with me this week, and the reason they're up here is because this entire family is going to camp with us. Yeah, that's great. So Dane and Eden here represent the third through fifth graders who are going with us. And y'all just pray, this is a chance for our third through fifth graders to experience and catch the joy of living in fellowship with other believers. A lot of them, this is their first time at camp, and they're going to spend a week just immersed in fun and Bible. And so we just pray that they get a passion for that. Ivan the fourth here is representing our student ministry. Pray that these students take their parents' faith and make it their own this week. There's a lot of decisions to be made. Some of them for full-time Christian ministry, and we're just praying that it will be a wonderful week for the students. And Ivan the third and his wife Erin are going along on the children's side as counselors. Y'all pray for the counselors, okay? They are going to deal with a lot this week. A lot of it's going to be crying kids who want to go home, and we're going to emphatically tell them, no, it's going to be great. You're going to have a great time. And so our counselors, we love them and we appreciate them. We appreciate families like this that are so bought into our church that they're going along. So keep our camp kids in your prayers this week, and we'll see you all on Friday. Hopefully we'll come back with as many as we leave with. Okay? All right. So thank y'all for being here, and you are sent.